So we're going to dedicate Bezrat Hashem this class to Devorah Bat Yehuda. Okay, we'll dedicate this for the other class, I'm sorry. So she'll get two dedications. So Sunday morning we like starting our day, our week with the Parashat HaShavua, what I can take from it, and I really hope that you're actually taking what we're learning every Sunday and applying it. As our sages say, Gadol HaTalmud HaMavi Lidei Maaseh, the learning is greater when you actually bring it into action. And the point is that I do want to grow spiritually. I don't have any desire standing in one point. And the whole point of taking this class is, besides enjoying it, is to actually do it, to apply it. And that's the point. So if you want to share later on some success stories, that will be great. During Shabbat, we always have some of our students telling us how they try to deal with it during Shabbat, how it affected them. That's the point. The point is to take something out of the door, not to leave it here. If you leave all your Torah here, that doesn't help. Not me, not you, not anybody else. So there's a story that the Alter Rebbe, the Baal HaTanya, was arrested at some point. We celebrated the date of liberation about a month and a half ago, Yutet Kislev. But since he was spreading out the teachings of Hasidut, when you do something good, there's always going to be opposition. So he was constantly getting arrested and getting investigated. So one time, he's sitting in the shul and wearing tefillin, wearing a talis. And one of his students come in and they're saying, listen, the police is here, they want to take you. So he tells them, I'm davening, let them wait. When I'm done, I'll go out. So he's finishing his prayers, and he decided not to take the talis off and not to take the tefillin off. And he goes with them, and they take him to the investigation. Now, as it is, they're already afraid of him, because they knew he's very, very powerful. There's a story that one time they arrested him, and they transported him on a boat from one part of the river to the other part of the river. And he told the driver of the boat, stop the boat because I need to say the blessing of the moon, Kiddush Levana. And he waved his hand like, so the Baal HaTanya made the boat stop. And he stood up, said, Birkat Levana. No, sorry. He made the boat stop and the boat didn't move. And then, of course, the driver looked back and he understood that he did it, and then he told him, okay, now you do it, so I'm not going to be responsible, so to say, for stopping the boat. So they knew he has special powers, so to say. So during the investigation, suddenly he took his hands and he went like this with the tefillin. I don't know if you ever noticed in a shul that the men, they straighten the tefillin. Many have the custom of actually having a mirror, and every 5-10 minutes looking in the mirror to make sure that tefillin is exactly in the middle of the head. Sometimes I go to shuls, the tefillin is here, and some guy tefillin is here, one time is here, and it's extremely important where the tefillin is sitting. So it's almost like you take a key, and if 1 millimeter of the key is not precise, it's not going to open the door. So the tefillin has to be exactly in the middle of the forehead. So he moved the tefillin. So they all got very, very affected by that, to a point that they really, really were afraid. And comes the end of the investigation, one of the investigators comes to him and tells him, tell me, what did you do with the tefillin there that we all got very affected, very afraid? So he says, listen, it says that when a Jewish man puts tefillin on his head, and all the nations will see that the name of God is upon you, and they will be afraid. And when the Talmud is explaining this pasuk, then it says, "Elu hem tefillin shebarosh." These are the tefillin of the head. So the investigator tells him, "Listen, I investigated a lot of Jews. I saw many Jews with tefillin on the head. That was not what you did." you did something, and it really, all of us were very afraid. So it says, he says, when the Talmud is talking about it, it says, Elohim tefillim shebarosh. Barosh means in the head, not tefillim shel rosh or al harosh, the tefillin that goes on the head. It's talking about the tefillin that is in the head, meaning that the whole point of the tefillin is that they're not going to be external, rather that they're going to be internal. That the power of the tefillin of the rosh will be in the head and not be removed from that. That not many people have. Now, what really is the power of the tefillin? Is that we put tefillin on my hand next to my heart to soften my heart, and I put tefillin on my head to affect my intellect and my mochin. That's the power of the tefillin. Now, if I keep it on the external part, then it didn't do much. It has to penetrate. Now, there are three covenants, three otot, between us and the Kadosh Baruch Hu that signify our eternal connection. And they have the acronym of the word Shabbat, which are Shabbat, Brit Milah, and Tefillin. Shabbat, of course, everybody knows. Brit Milah is circumcision, and Tefillin is what we wear 6 days a week. Now, Shabbat is once a week. Brit Milah is once in your lifetime. But Tefillin is every day, of course, besides Shabbos and Yom Tov. So you can derive from that that Tefillin has the most powerful covenant, that it's every day I'm doing it. Now it says that a man has to have at least one of them, at least two of them constantly. So Shabbat you can only have on Shabbat, and circumcision you carry it around, it's every day. So when Shabbat is, I can't put tefillin, so during the week I put tefillin. So I constantly have these two connections with the Kadosh Baruch Hu. And I know you're wondering, what does that got to do with you? Because you don't put tefillin, and only the men get circumcised. At the end of the class, I'll tell you why you don't do that, and how is that connected to you. But these are the three covenants that we have with the Kadosh Baruch Hu, and this is what signifies our internal and in-depth connection with the Master of the Universe. Now, what is really the concept of the tefillin? Is to remind us that I constantly have to control my heart. Constantly, I have to be in a battle of controlling my heart, what's called my yetzer. Now, why am I talking about tefillin? This parasha is not, it's about Yetziat Mitzrayim. But if you fast forward to the end of the parasha, it's the first time we are commanded to put tefillin on. In this parasha, it's talking about the last three plagues. It's talking about the locusts, about the darkness, and the Makat Bechorot, the last Makah. And then, of course, the epic moment when they leave Mitzrayim. This is one of the most powerful parashot in the Torah. And at the end, the last three psukim is just talking about that we have to put tefillin. It's actually talking about two mitzvot that we have to do. And these mitzvot are about remembering the leaving of Mitzrayim. One mitzvah is tefillin, and the other mitzvah is kiddush, is the sanctifying the firstborn, that not everybody gets to do, because you need to have a firstborn. Kadesh lich kol b'chor peter. If I have a firstborn is a son, then I have to do pidyon ben. And if I have only girls, or my first child is a girl, then I don't do it. Not everybody gets to do this mitzvah. But since the last makah, the last plague, was about killing the firstborn, so the Kadosh Baruch Hu commanded us that I have to, so to say, sanctify the firstborn, if he's a son, to the Kadosh Baruch Hu. This is called Pidyon HaBen. Maybe you saw it, they take the child, they do a big party, and they give a lot of treats and jewelry. And so these are the two mitzvot at the end of the parasha is talking about. Now, if you noticed, and we mentioned it over Shabbat, that every day, constantly, in our prayers, and almost anything that I do, is constantly I'm reminding myself the going out of Egypt. Zecher Letziat Mitzrayim. When I'm praying Shacharit, Mincha, and Arvit, is constantly this concept of to remember that I left Egypt. Everything that we do. On Shabbat I do Kiddush, Zecher Letziat Mitzrayim. Everything is constantly reminding me the leaving of Egypt. And in the tefillin, וכשרתם לאות על ידיך ויהיו תותפות בין עיניך, you have to have a sign on your hand and a remembrance on your hand. למען תזכור את יום צאתך מארץ מצרים, for the sake that you remember that you left the day you left Egypt. So constantly we are requested, so to say, to remember leaving Mitzrayim. The funniest thing is that unfortunately we have a very short memory. 75 years ago we experienced one of the horrors in our history, the Holocaust. And if you now go out to the street, unfortunately, and you ask little kids what's the Holocaust, some will know, some will not know. You know, three generations already passed. Two generations ago, everybody was scarred. One generation ago, when I was a kid, it was also pretty thrown into our face. Now go to school, tell them the Holocaust. Something I think my great-grandfather. And that's only 75 years ago, and that's a pretty serious thing. This is not a small event. And the reason why we don't really remember it, first of all, our mind constantly wants to get rid of bad memories. But certain things Hashem does in order for us to remember, to know something, so I can commemorate it and learn for the future. And honestly, there's not enough remembering something like the Holocaust. So they made a few museums, and once a year there's the Yom HaShoah, the Day of Holocaust, and that's it. And if Chas V'Shalom Mashiach is not going to come anytime soon, in 10, 20, 30 years, people are not going to remember. It's going to be just another event in history. So how can it be that 3,300 years ago, Yetziat Mitzrayim happened? Ask almost any Jewish kid, what's Yetziat Mitzrayim? Doesn't matter if he's religious or not. They'll tell you, oh, we were slaves in Egypt, and there were plagues, and we celebrated, and we ate matzahs. And why? Because we constantly, every day, pushing, remember Yetziat Mitzrayim, Yetziat Mitzrayim, the leaving of Egypt, the leaving of Egypt. We're living it. We're living it every day. And the mitzvah that, so to say, comes right away to remind us is in this parasha, at the end, talking about tefillin, that the tefillin is to remind us that we left Mitzrayim. But really, the tefillin is coming to do a completely different thing. The tefillin is not necessarily to remind me about Yetziat Mitzrayim. Rather, I tie it on my hand, like I said before, close to my heart, to soften and to break my yetzel, so to say, my inclination and desires and lust. And I put it on my head to affect my mochin, my intellect, my thoughts. Because I have a daily battle between my thoughts and I have a daily battle between my heart, my desires and my inclinations and lusts and weaknesses. Now, really we are required to control our thoughts. This is one of the most hardest things that we need to do. But we are required by the Torah to control our thoughts. And really, is it possible to control your thoughts?
Yes.
It's not possible. It is, but it's not easy. Sorry, I'm going to rephrase it. Is it possible? Yes. Is it easy? Not at all. Now, we have two powers that we're battling all day long. One of them is my thoughts, that all day long I have thoughts running in my mind. And another part is my desires, what my heart desires, what I want, my inclination, lusts, and so forth. And I'm constantly desired to fight with it. Now, is it easy? No. Is it possible? Yes and no. I can already tell you that thoughts are possible. The heart is almost impossible. Because the heart is built in such a way that it's almost impossible to control my heart. What I want to get to a point is that I bring my intellect to control the heart. This is called Moach Shalit al Lev, that my mind will control the heart, like a wild animal, because the heart is almost impossible to control. So, just to kind of give a very quick overview, this parasha, we're looking that Hashem is trying to break Paro with the last three makot. Last parasha is talking about the seven first plagues, that we spoke about it last week, that the first five plagues Paro still had the option of doing tshuva and stopping them. And the next five plagues, that already Hashem says, I'm going to harden his heart. That was his punishment for not letting them go the first time. We mentioned about the whole free choice that Paro had, because Paro could have let them go right from the beginning. We spoke last week about the free choice, that is it really fair that Paro got punished? He was a puppet. It was all predicted, it was prophesied that they're going to be, that there's going to be the exile. Why, so to say, not that I'm advocating Paro, but why did he get punished? He got punished because he was already slaving the Jews for 84 years before Moshe Rabbeinu came. Technically, he could have said, okay, I'm done my job, go, take them. But he did not want to. Hashem gave him five options, five opportunities to repent. He decided not to. Then Hashem said, okay, now I'm going to punish you. And the last five plagues, but it was already a punishment. In this parasha, we see that the last three makot, the plagues, are the most harsh ones. And we see that Hashem is basically, what he's doing is trying to break Paro. Because already here, Paro was already stubborn. And Hashem was like, okay, I'm going to break him. I'm going to show everybody how I can break Paro. Even though he's stubborn. Because we all have a certain midah, a certain attribute that is called akshanut, being stubborn. Now if you empower this midah, this attribute, for something positive, that's very good. So you're going to be very stubborn to understand what you learn, and you're going to be very stubborn to be very particular about the mitzvot that you do. But if you take this midah of akshanut, of stubbornness, to something negative, then it just causes you problems, because you're going with your head against the wall. So we see already from this parasha that the point is the fight between the stubbornness of Paro. And we mentioned last week and during Shabbat that each and every one of us has a Paro in me, a Mitzri, so to say. Our sages teach us, v'chol dor v'dor, chayav adam lirot atzmo kilu yatza mimitzrayim. Every generation a person has to see himself like as if he left Egypt. What does it really mean? Don't I have to imagine that I'm carrying a backpack and a matzah? No, it means that I have to see in myself how I have to live my own Mitzrayim. That's why comes the Baal HaTanya and he says, no, b'chol yom v'yom chayav adam lirot atzmo kilu yatza mimitzrayim. Every day, I have to imagine myself as if I'm leaving Mitzrayim, and again, not with a backpack and a few donkeys and matzahs, that I'm going out of my limitation. Mitzrayim comes from the word meitzar. Meitzar is a limit. I'm full of limitations. And I have to constantly fight my limit, something that limits me, and go out of my Mitzrayim. And if I did that today, then tomorrow I'll have another limitation. And it never ends. And what is one of the powers that limits me is the Mitzri, is the Egyptian in me, is that Paro that has the midah of akshanut. No, I don't want to. Instead of doing it, I don't want to do it. And I have to break this Mitzri. We read last week that it says that Moshe Rabbeinu went out from the house of Paro. He grew up in the house of Paro. And then he sees a Mitzri, an Egyptian man, hitting a Jew. And the Torah tells us, V'istakel kovacho, he looked one side and then he looked to the other side. And he killed the Mitzri and then he buried him. Now, Moshe Rabbeinu did not kill him with his bare hands. He didn't have a gun or a knife. And he definitely did not have a shovel to bury him. When the Torah says, Yistakel Ko, Ko is written Kaf Vav, which is a numerical value of 26, and then another Kaf Vav, another numerical value of 26. The name of Yud Kei Vav Kei is a numerical value of 26. So when he says, Yistakel Ko, he said one Shem Eforash, one holy name of the Kadosh Baruch Hu, and the Mitzri died. And then he said another name Eforash, another holy name, and the ground swallowed him. Moshe Rabbeinu did not physically kill him. He just had to say something. But this comes to bring us to understand that we have a nitzotz, we have a spark of Moshe Rabbeinu in me, which means that I have the ability to kill the Mitzri in me. And it's not with my hands, it's with a holy name. That's how I can kill the Mitzri that is in me. So this parasha is coming to finalize that I'm coming to break the Egyptian, the Mitzri, the Meitzar, the Gvul in me. And after that, how do I do that and how do I remember that? By remembering that the one who actually took me out of Mitzrayim is the Kadosh Baruch Hu. That's why Moshe Rabbeinu had to use the name of the Kadosh Baruch Hu. All these miracles, all these plagues, Moshe Rabbeinu would just say holy names. Every time he would say a different name, and up, something would happen. Same with splitting the sea. Moshe Rabbeinu said a combination of holy names, and he split the sea. He had a very special staff. People were imagining the staff of Moshe like a branch that is looking like a piece of wood. It says that it was 6 amah tall. This is about 3 meters high. And it was in the shape of a square made out of sapphire. And it wasn't stam like a little piece of wood. It was a very special staff. Very soon, Bezrat Hashem, we're going to see it. When Moshiach is going to come, he's going to give it back to Moshe Rabbeinu. But Moshe Rabbeinu on the staff had all the Shemot HaMeforashim, all the holy names of the Kadosh Baruch Hu. That Moshe Rabbeinu, Hashem would tell him, use this name, he would say it, and up, the universe would shift. In essence, first of all, we are not allowed to mention these names, but in essence, we can shift the world and the universe with these holy names. That's constantly why I need to say brachot, and I pray, and I learn Torah, because in them, there's already the names of the Kadosh Baruch Hu. But in this, the end of the parasha is instructing me to do 2 mitzvot in order for me to remember the Yetziat Mitzrayim. And we mentioned Tfilin and Pidyon HaBen, sanctifying the firstborn. Now, amazingly, we see that there's no information about in the Torah about Tfilin. There's not even one word, there's not even the word Tfilin in the Torah. It says Ot and Totafot. And in order for me to know how to put Tfilin on, it's only in the Oral Torah. And in the process of doing Tfilin, I have to take the leather, I have to take an animal, a kosher animal, and I have to skin it, and I have to process the skin, and the process is so long, and then it has to be so precise, and it's not only the exterior, I have to write the parchment, and make the parchment, and what do I write in the parchment, and how do I put the parchment? So, there's not one word in the Torah that is explaining to us about anything about Tfilin. And the Kozari, there's a book by Rabbi Yehuda Levi, he's called the Kozari, he says this is the proof the Torah Shebe'al Peh, that the oral Torah is part of the Torah. Because any man knows about Tfilin. And if Chas V'Shalom, there are certain people that they don't believe in the oral Torah, and they follow just the written Torah. And here they have a problem. Because there's no we're talking about Tfilin, so they can't do this mitzvah. And a lot of people, they have different names, different groups, that they say, I only follow the written Torah. So I don't cook a calf in its mother's milk, but cheeseburgers are fine. And I don't light fire on Shabbat, but anything else is fine. So here they have a serious problem, because they can't put Tfilin on, because they can't perform this mitzvah. So the entire explanation of Tfilin is in the Oral Torah. And almost any man, doesn't matter who it is, at some point must have put one time in his life Tfilin. Very few men, they never had the opportunity to put Tfilin on, but I have full confidence in the Chabadnikim that they will find him, anywhere they are. So, but most men, go now to any man from anywhere in the world, and you'll tell him what is like the most dominating mitzvah for a man, oh, Tfilin. It's quick, it's easy. But there's no recollection about Tfilin in the Torah. It only says Ot, which is a sign, and then it says Totafot. Now, Totafot is not even a word in Hebrew. Totafot, it comes from a language that is called Afrikai, and it's divided into 2 words, Tat and Pat. And it's 2 and 2. If you're looking at the tefillin of the head, it has these lines. And the lines, they're not external, it's internal. Internal, the tefillin is divided into 4 boxes. And in each box is 1 parasha from the Torah. Now there are, of course, different types of tefillin in regards to the order of the tefillin. There are 4 types. There are contradiction between 4 commentaries. The Rashi, Rabbeinu Tam, Rabad, and Shimush HaRabba. These are the 4 types that they argue how to put the order of the Tfilin. The majority goes by Rashi. Very few people put Shimush HaRabba and Rabad. But a lot of men also put Tfilin that is called Rabbeinu Tam. Now, Rabbeinu Tam, I'm just giving you a little overview about the Tfilin. Rabbeinu Tam is Rashi's grandson. And there's a funny story that one time, many shuls, many congregations, they have the custom that you put two pairs of tefillin. Some put it at the same time. They have very small tefillin and they put two at the same time. And some they put first, they do most of the shacharit with Rashi, then they take it off and they put tefillin of Rabbeinu Tam. The difference is the order of the parchments in the tefillin. So there's a funny story that one time a person came into a shul, and the shul was the type of congregation that prays with both tefillin, and he saw a pair of tefillin on the table. So he tells the person next to him, "Can I use this tefillin?" So in his mind, he wanted to make sure that he's known, that he's correct. So he says, no, this tefillin is Rabbeinu Tam's, meaning you can only put them after the prayer. So he says, okay, I'll put them now, and when Rabbeinu Tam comes, I'll give it back to him. So there's a lot of funny things going on with Rabbeinu Tam. But what's the concept with Rabbeinu Tam? First of all, who's Rabbeinu Tam, and why Rashi? Rashi was one of the most famous commentators in history that has commentary in the entire Torah and the Oral Torah, to a point that you can't even learn the Oral Torah without Rashi. And Rashi did not have boys. He only had four girls. And one of the girls got married. Her name was Yocheved, and she got married with a very famous rabbi, and his name is Rabbi Meir. It's not the famous Rabbi Meir Balanes, that's 1,000 years before that, but he was a very, very big rabbi of the generation, and his name was Rabbi Meir. They had four sons. Two of them became giants in the Torah. One of them was Shmuel, and he's known as the Rashbam, Rabbi Shmuel ben Meir. If you open any book of Oral Torah or many of the Mefarshim, you see there's a commentator named Rashbam. And the next one is Rabbeinu Tam. Now, his name was not Tam. Tam, because he was very, very tamim. He was like Yaakov, Ish Tam Yoshev Oalim. So he was known to be a very, very big Talmid Chacham. And his name was Yaakov. So he got the nickname of Rabbeinu Tam. Now, Rabbeinu Tam, he in most cases, constantly contradicts Rashi. Bechlal, if you look at the Gemara, if you open the Talmud, you see that the Talmud is centered, the Gemara itself is centered in the middle, and on one side you'll have Rashi, and one side you'll have what's called the Tosafot. Tosafot is the additions, and the Tosafot are all Rashi's grandsons. And they constantly contradict him, and they're arguing with him. And the story says that one time Rashi was sitting and writing his commentary, and he had a lot of grandsons, so Rashi was also a scribe, a sofer. So he's sitting and he's writing, it doesn't say if it was a mezuzah, if it was tefillin, but he's writing it, and Rabbeinu Tam, a little kid, he was a little boy, and he was playing with some toy, and he threw something, and that whatever it was, I don't know if it doesn't say it was a marble, some toy of a child, went into the little dish with all the ink, and the whole ink went upside down on the parchment and ruined the whole parchment. So then Rashi says, I see now that when it comes to the tefillin, writing the tefillin, one day you're gonna contradict me, that now you turned my ink up on over my parchment and you ruined my parchment. And sure enough, Rabbeinu Tam comes many years later and he contradicts Rashi and he says, no, the order of the parchment has to be different. And according to Rashi, it goes by more common sense. I don't want to go into the whole argument here. And Rabbeinu Tam says, no, it has to go by the order. But anyways, Rabbeinu Tam, that's the concept of the tefillin of Rabbeinu Tam. Of course, Lehalacha, to halacha, most people go by Rashi. The reason why we put Rabbeinu Tam, and I'm telling you that because I know some of your husbands probably do put Rabbeinu Tam, is because we want to make sure that if Chas v'Shalom the halacha is by Rabbeinu Tam, I don't want to go up to Shamayim and meet Rabbeinu Tam with his long beard and tells me, you didn't put tefillin on your whole life. What am I going to tell him? I put Rashi? He's going to tell me, no, it's by me. So we add a little addition, And we put also the tefillin of Rabbeinu Tam. Now, in our generations we don't do it, but in previous generations the men would all day long wear tefillin, especially if they would sit in a yeshiva. We know the famous Rabbi Yochanan never ever took his tefillin off. Not even once. All day long he would be, of course not, he wouldn't go to sleep with it. But during the day, from morning to night, he would wear his tefillin on. Lehalacha, to halacha, you're not allowed to walk 4 amot, which is about 2 meters, without tefillin. So Rabbi Yochanan never took his tefillin off. And there's a story also in a story with Rabbi Eliezer. Rabbi Eliezer once was hosted by a very famous, a very big rich person. And you know, in our generation, somebody who has money, so in their backyard, they have a pool. In the older generation, somebody had money, what did they have in the backyard? A mikveh. Because mikveh was not like today that every 2 meters you have a mikveh. So somebody had money, he had a mikveh in their home. So, and it wasn't so common. So this Rabbi Eliezer came to this rich man who hosted him, and he wanted to spoil him, and he told him, why don't you go to the backyard, I have a mikveh. Of course, Rabbi Eliezer got very, very excited. He goes to the mikveh, takes his clothes off, takes his tefillin off, and goes into the mikveh. So the rich guy comes out, no, why are you going in this one? That's the dirty one, go over there, that's the clean one. So Rabbi Eliezer goes out, dries himself, gets dressed, puts the tefillin on, walks the few feet away, takes the tefillin off, takes the clothes off, and goes into the clean mikveh. So our sages were the type of individuals that did not remove the tefillin off their body for 1 second. In our generations, men are just can't wait to take them off. I mean, sometimes as I go to shuls, they put the tefillin on and off in the speed of lightning. So the point that I'm trying to get, I'm giving you just the overview about tefillin. Excuse me? Okay, they didn't go out of Egypt, unfortunately. But the thing is that the concept of tefillin is to make me have the ability to control my thoughts. It's all about controlling my thoughts. To control my heart, as I said in the beginning, is almost impossible. And there's a story about a certain Tana. His name is Rabbi Matya ben Charash. But Rabbi Matya ben Charash was a very good friend of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. Now he had a yeshiva in Romi. Now they say that he was greater than Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. That's what they say. What's his name? Rabbi Matya ben Charash. He was, I don't know if he's the same age of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. The Gemara says that they were friends, but there are many places that say that he was actually greater than Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. There's a story in the Gemara that one time Rashbi went to visit him in Romi, and the Talmidim, you know, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai was still, they had a lot of respect to him. So they asked him a question in Halacha, and Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai gave a very special answer. And then they said kind of like, not Chas V'Shalom in a laughing way, but like, oh wow, he was able to say a chidush like our Rebbe, Rabbi Matya. So there are many different places that say that Rabbi Matya ben Charash was actually much, much greater than Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, but he was a very humble sage and it was not known. The story says that when Rabbi Matya ben Charash would study, he would shake the heavens. And one time he was concentrating in his studies and the whole heavens were shaken. So the Satan, the devil, could not take it, and he came down to the world and he dressed himself in the shape of a woman. And the story says that it was like the most beautiful, beautiful woman ever existed in the world, and he was trying to get his attention off the studies. And he stood in front of him, so he went like that. So he moved over here, so he went like that. He did not want to look at the beautiful woman. So at some point he saw that the Satan is not leaving him alone. He took 2 nails and he nails his eyelids down into to the skin. So he's not going to be able to look and see the woman. That's what the Gemara says. Of course the Satan went up all the way up to Shamayim and begged for forgiveness in front of Hashem. He says, listen, I didn't mean for him to poke his eyes. I just wanted to get him distracted. And of course, Hashem accepted the tshuva of the Satan, sent Malach Raphael, cured Rabbi Matya's eyes right away, and it was a Hollywood ending and everything was good. But what we learned from that is that nobody even somebody as great as Rabbi Matya ben Charash, who's supposedly greater than Rabbi Shimon bar Yochai, he also was afraid to fail and not to be able to control his heart. Now the heart is being controlled by my eyes, because how do our sages say, what my eyes see, my heart wants. So it starts with my eyes. My heart, if I will shut my eyes, or if I will be living in a cave, most likely 50% of my desires, I won't have them. And I'll walk in the street, doesn't matter who I am, if I see something very, very nice, my heart wants it, it desires it. So it can be in many different things. It can be even not even in something. I mean, I know a lot of people, their thought goes right away to, you know, man walks in the street, he sees something right away, his heart desires that. But that can be also for a woman. You go in on Fifth Avenue and you're looking in a beautiful store. Ooh, I like that beautiful dress. So women also have this weakness in the heart. It's just not the men. Men are known to have even greater weakness. That's why we see a lot of the examples we have in the Talmud talking about the men, not the women. But the fact is that everybody has desires, inclination, lusts, and it's the heart that's controlling it. What we learn from this story is that it's almost impossible, and just for the sake of this example, I would say impossible, to control my heart. I'm saying impossible because there's always a way, but just to emphasize what I need to take from that is it's impossible to control my heart. But it is possible to control my mind. And that's why it says that, how does the mitzvah of tefillin goes? Ukshartem le'ot al yedecha. You have to tie it on your hand. Now to tie, what does it mean? That every time I have to tie it again. It means I have to repeat it every day. This is called avodah shebalev, working on my heart. But when it's talking about the Rosh, it says, v'yul le'totafot ben enecha. Meaning that it stays there. It doesn't move. Now, why dafka between the eyes? I mean, the Torah doesn't really tell us. Like I said before, the Torah doesn't mention anything about tefillin. When it says, v'yul le'kshatam le'ot al yedecha, tie a covenant on your hand. What should I tie? Maybe I put this on my hand. Like, what do I put on my hand? And to tafot ben enecha, well, maybe I can put a potato between my eyes. The reason why I put it on my hand is that the power of the tefillin, I should wrap the same way that I'm wrapping my hand, that's how I have to wrap my heart to control my desires. But when I put it between my eyes, is first of all, I know that my eyes are the gates that see everything. Whatever my eyes see, that's what they want. The eyes see, the heart wants, the mind starts thinking how I'm going to get it. So the tefillin of the Rosh is not about tying it. Tying is constant, every day, to redo it. But totafot ben enecha is that I have to place it in my brain, that I constantly have to have this control over my brain. And this is where it comes to it's no separate between women and men. We'll get to why men put it and women don't put it. But the point is that I have a very weak point, and that's called my heart. And I constantly want things, and with no control. And after this class, we're going to learn about the month of Shvat, and the motion, the sense of Shvat is called achila, eating, consuming, wanting, constantly want to take in. So my heart constantly wants to, I want. Doesn't matter what it is. You use your own imagination to what my heart wants. And unfortunately, we're slaves to our hearts. And if Chas v'Shalom will go after my heart, I will be a slave all day long to what my heart wants. I want to sleep, I want to eat, I want to procreate, I want to be rich, I want to have money, I want to travel. And then my mind starts manipulating the situation, how am I going to get it? So here we come and we say, don't even try to fight with your heart. You're not going to be able to fight with your heart. The heart is in the possession of the Nefesh HaBehemit. But what you are required to do is to control your mind. Your mind you can control. Your mind, you can develop the systems how to control your thoughts. Now there's a story that I heard not too long ago, and I found it extremely, extremely fascinating, because we're all human beings. There's no difference between one and other. People sometimes look at me, they think I'm like an angel, and oh no, I wish I would be you. And I don't wish to be me. A lot of times I go to lectures, you probably don't have a yetzer hara. I would wish I had your experience. And my yetzer hara is a commando yetzer hara. This is like a ninja yetzer hara. There's no bigger yetzer hara. I will give you my yetzer hara. Any day you want him, I'll give it to you for one day. The Gemara says, "Kechol shekocho gover, kach yitzro gover." The more you grow in your spiritual power, your yetzer hara will grow with you. It's not going to be fair to put a three-year-old in a ring with Mike Tyson. So you have to put somebody that he can handle. But every human being has a yetzer hara. Unless you are a complete tzaddik, what's called tzaddik gamur, that's a whole different thing. But even a tzaddik she'ino gamur, what does it mean tzaddik she'ino gamur? Tzaddik feralo, tzaddik that still has some bad in it. It doesn't come out, but there's still bad in it. So we're not even a level of being close to a tzaddik. So much more so, we are even a level of maybe if we're lucky, rasha v'tovlo. We're all in the definition of a rasha because we fail a lot. But we all have a problem with our hearts. So it has to be some type of a system. How do I control it? Because I do not want my heart to control my life. And unfortunately, most people, they have something that it controls their life. And I don't want to. Just the other day, some guy met me in the mikveh. And we're talking, and he wanted some help. And I told him, take my secretary's number and call her. He's like, no, just give me your number. I told him, I don't have a number. He's like, what do you mean you don't have a number? I said, I have a number in my home and my number in my office. I don't carry a phone with me. He's like, you don't have a phone? I said, no. Why should I carry a phone? 20 years ago, who had phones? 30 years ago, 40 years ago, 50 years ago, who had phones? This is an epidemic of our generation. 20 years ago, big businessmen did not have phones. They had the time, call me in my office, I'll check my messages in 3 hours. What's the difference now? Do you have to have a phone? Do I need some radiating metal piece in my pocket? Every 2 seconds in my pocket? Well, why do I need it? To be bothered all day long? I don't have a phone. He couldn't fathom the idea that, how did you not walk with a phone? I told him, I don't want to be slave to this box. I don't want to be that every second that this box goes ding ding to jump on it like as if Mashiach is here. Give me a box that will do this. When Mashiach comes, that I'll carry with me. But to take a radiating piece of metal that I have to be a slave to it? That if I forget it at home, people lose their mind. My phone! My phone! So I don't want to be a slave to my phone. So I don't want to be a slave to anything. I used to be a smoker for 15 years. I don't want to be. I decided I don't want to. What, am I going to be slave to a piece of stick that has nicotine in it, that ruins my health? I'm just thinking of the psychological warfare here. So we constantly are slaves to our desires, and we don't even notice. And we let this desire put me in Mitzrayim. I'm in slavery. Doesn't matter what it is. Can be food, can be cigarettes, can be sleeping, can be anything. Some of the things seems on the surface that they're not even harmful. It's not harmful to carry a phone with me. It actually is. Go and look at research, as you'll see, you're carrying a radiating machine that affects us so bad that we don't even realize how much this machine is affecting us. It's not a machine, it's a device. It's such strong radiation that researchers are saying that in America, if Chas V'Shalom Mashiach is not coming anytime soon, by the year 2025, every second American will have cancer. That's how bad this device is. It's just as bad in Israel. And people don't understand. They're moody, they're depressed, they're sick, they're cancer, tumors, kids are ADD, all these things. 90% comes from this little thing. So psychologically, one says, oh, it's not harmful. It's helping me. It is harmful. So how many smokers are in the world? Millions of smokers. I would smoke for 15 years. And you know how I quit smoking? Hypnotism. I couldn't quit smoking. I would smoke 3 packs a day of cigarettes. I would chain smoker. Then my lighter, I didn't need a lighter because I would go from cigarette to cigarette. And how I quit smoking, that's a whole different story. I'll tell you another time. It's a miracle. It had to be a miracle. But the way how I quit, the tool in nature was hypnotism. And hypnotism is moach shalit al halev. The mind controls the heart. And I left out of the room, not smoking, till today. Wow. That's the power of the mind. I walked into the room and out of the room. Of course, it had to be with the power of the Kadosh Baruch Hu. It had to be a miracle. The Kadosh Baruch Hu has to be a component here. But how it worked is Moach Shalit Alev. Mind controls the heart. And I walked out of the room holding a cigarette. I didn't want to smoke it. So anything can be, the mind is so powerful that it can control the heart any second it wants. I just have to allow my mind to control it. So the story that I told you that I heard that I found extremely fascinating is that many years ago in Brooklyn, where the Lubavitcher Rebbe used to reside, an empire grew and constantly they needed more help. So they needed another secretary to help the Rebbe. So at the time, the rabbi was in charge with was an individual called Rabbi Chodakov. And they told him, go and look for an individual that can be suitable to be one of the Rebbe's secretary. So he went down to the Beit Midrash and asked around, and then he pulled a young man by the name of Rabbi Klein. He was a young student from Yerushalayim, and they told him, this is a very special individual. He's going to be a suitable guy. Who, of course, whoever knows the group of Mazkirim, his one, he, up until the day that he left the world, was one of the days, the Mazkirim of the Lubavitcher Rebbe, and his name is Rabbi Klein. And he was a very, very special individual. But when he came, they showed him around. Here's this room, here's that room, here's this. So they gave him an introduction. And then Rabbi Chodakov came to him and he told him, listen, you have to understand what's going on here. This is like a pentagon. We have secret information here. We have personal information. People, you don't even know who calls the Rebbe for advice. Governors, ministers, presidents, you name it, we have so much secret information going on here. This is not some another shul. Because really, leaders of the world call to consult the Lubavitcher Rebbe. And we're holding secret information here of personal people. I cannot tell you, I cannot control your eyes. You are going to see what you're going to see. So I can't tell you to control your eyes. And I can't tell you to control your ears because you're going to hear things. But one thing that I can tell you is control your mouth. You cannot talk. I cannot stop you from seeing what you're going to see. And I cannot stop you from hearing what you're about to hear. But I am going to tell you, close your mouth. You can control your mouth. When I heard that story, you know, in the first glance, I was like, okay, no. Another story. And I was like, no, look at that. My eyes, I cannot control my eyes. I have to live in the world. I am going to walk in the street. I'm going to see all sorts of things that tempt me. And I'm going to hear all sorts of things that stimulate my heart. So I cannot control it. But I can control the power of dibur. Speaking is the power of action. That I can control. That's in my power to control. And that's exactly us, that we are constantly involved in the world. I cannot segregate myself and live in a cave. So my eyes are the view of my soul. So my heart constantly wants, I want more, I want more. You just go next to the bakery here and you see these beautiful cakes. Oh, I just want a cake. I only have three of them. It's not that bad. It's only like 5 pounds of sugar, but it's only a cake. And then I walk another store and I want this and I want that. So to control my eyes is impossible. To control my heart, just for now, don't take my words out of context, let's call it impossible. But I can control my thoughts, and what I want to take out of that is that thoughts can be controlled. And that's the reason why we put tefillin on every day, is that I can control my thoughts. It gives me the power that throughout the day, I can move away my thoughts. A thought will come to my mind, but I can move it right away. There are many different ways how to control your thoughts, because the thoughts I can control. The heart is almost impossible. But then you will ask me, we don't put filling on. I don't put filling on. So first of all, you have a husband. And it's your obligation to make sure that he puts filling on. You push him out of his bed at 6 in the morning. And if he doesn't go out of the bed at 6 in the morning, then make sure he goes at 7. And if he doesn't go at 7, you kick him out of bed at 8. But you make sure that your husband puts tefillin on. And if you're not in the place that your husband puts tefillin on, or you're young, or chas v'shalom lo aleinu widow, the divorce, then first of all, you might have a son. And you make sure that your son puts tefillin on. A single girl, till she gets married, her potential husband is already putting tefillin for her. And once she gets married, then her husband is fulfilling the mitzvah for her. And if chas v'shalom the husband passes away, or there's a divorce, then there's either going to be a child, there's either going to be a next husband. But the man fulfills the mitzvah for the women. Some situations, the woman does not have that opportunity. Then she needs to be participating in the mitzvah of tefillin. I mentioned before we have a fund of food, we have a fund for tefillin. So I have a lot of ladies that tell me, I'm single. I don't have a husband. So buy somebody that doesn't have tefillin, participate in the mitzvah of tefillin. You're not allowed to buy the whole pair, because the person who buys his own tefillin has to have some part in it. Even in the funds that we have, we help people that don't have money to buy tefillin. We only pay 75%, because 25% at least, the person who buys the tefillin, he has to buy it with his own money. If not, it's not his tefillin. And then it means that anyone can take it, and he needs to own it. But if a woman doesn't have the opportunity, then she participates in the mitzvah of tefillin. And if not in the actual mitzvah, then supporting the cause of tefillin. And there's many ways to be participating in the mitzvah of tefillin. But a woman, even by praying shacharit in the morning, it's like as if she put her tefillin on. The concept here is that the tefillin can be put in the physical level and also in the mental and spiritual level. So women are by default more holier, they need less physical things. The point here is that you can do the exact same thing without actually putting the tefillin on. Is the knowledge and the concept of how am I controlling my thoughts? How am I actually moving my thought when a wrong thought comes? I mean, thoughts are constantly going to come into my mind. The point is not to fight the thought or try to control it, is to bring in a new thought. That's the advice. Because any bad thought that comes to your mind, you can't really fight it. The only thing you can do is actually push it. How do you push it? With a new thought, with a pure thought. And you already acquire what are these pure thoughts that you want to add in your bank of thoughts that will thrown in right away. A psalm that you like, a certain chapter in a book that you like, a certain concept, something that you learned. So even for a woman that is not required and obligated by and bound by time, it is highly recommended that when you start your day, you start your day with a prayer. And if you cannot pray the prayer of Shacharit, then you do right away the morning prayers. That you have some type of holy thought in your mind. That you're going to have something memorized in your mind. You know, what I was advised how to fight a thought is memorize Mishnayot of my heart. Or memorize Psukim, verses of Tehillim. That when you have a bad thought, right away push it and chant that Pasuk in your mind. Or the Mishnah. Why? Because the mind now, you diverse the mind. You change the path, so to say, and now I'm busy chanting a certain chapter or a Mishnah or something. So since you don't put tefillin on, that's something you should do. You take some chapters of Tehillim, you memorize the Psukim. You have a bad thought, you can't fight the thought. So you can remove it with pushing it away and bringing something in that is holy. And the whole point of the fight of the thought is not to win the thought, is to move it. And the major part here, the problem with the thoughts, because the thoughts, most of it are not ours. 99% of the thoughts that are injected into my mind is not my thoughts. We mentioned in the class of the Gates of Reincarnation that we have three garments that our soul gets dressed in, which the highest garment is called the garment of thought, machshava. Most of the thoughts that I have are not my thoughts. They're called what's called machshava zara, a foreign thought. It's not my thought. It's a separate entity came and injected this thought into my brain. It can be the yetzer hara, it can be a certain klipa, a negative force that will come and throw a thought into my mind. And the thoughts are like these bad friends that you hang out with in school. When I was in school, I had a few good friends and I had the bad friends that I hung out with. Hey, you want to come and have a smoke? So these thoughts are these bad friends that they just want to pull you to them. Besides that, you have two agents stuck in the front of your face that they go and register and see things and they translate things into your thoughts. The point is not to feed the thoughts. You have a bad thought, is not to feed it. If I have a bad thought and I push it right away, then, you know, some thoughts are so bad, one can be punished for their thoughts. Thoughts are much worse than an actual action. They actually say that the sin in the level of the thought is worse than the sin in the level of action. Thinking of the sin is worse than doing the sin. Because you damage the garment of the thought. You let it penetrate to the inner surface of your being. It's not external. Something external, you can brush it off. This goes and penetrates all the way into the deepest garment. And it affects your neshama. So the point is not to feed your thought. Sometimes some thought will come to your mind, and instead of sitting there and starting to feed the thought, you have to push it away. That's where we get into trouble, then we start developing the thought. And whatever it is. So the point to take from here is that I have a daily, weekly, annually, and my entire life battle is I have to battle with my heart and I have to battle with my thoughts all day long. Some people, the battle is so long that they become a little bit unstable because the mind, too much, overwhelming. That's too much thoughts going on and with zero control over it. So the point here is to know and to learn how to start controlling my thoughts. And if I control my thoughts, I control my heart. My heart cannot be controlled, rather I need to control it over through my thoughts. And the way to do it is whether I put my physical tefillin on or my spiritual tefillin on. And a woman, maybe she doesn't put the physical tefillin on, but if you have a son and you educate the son to go in the path of the Torah and you make sure that the son goes to a Talmud Torah to learn Torah, that someday he will be a man that will put tefillin on every day, you have a shayachut to it, you have a connection to that. And so much more so, you have to help your husband. So for the ones that do already have a husband, then you have to make sure in your way that your husband puts tefillin on every day. And if he doesn't, then that should be your agenda, how important it is. And in your own way to put tefillin on, you don't necessarily have to put the box on your head. You can do it in your own spiritual way. The important thing to take from the tefillin of the Rosh is that if you ever looked at it, it has a box, and then it has long, long, long straps that go all the way down. If you go ever to a shul of a tzaddik, you'll see that the straps go all the way down, all the way down. According to halacha, there's many different contradictions. One has to come to the stomach, to the belly button, that's how you say, tabur, belly button, has to come to the belly button, and the other one till the area of the Brit Milah. There's different opinions. But the tzaddikim, I saw some of them, that the tefillin goes all the way down to the ground, and they tie it in their gartel, so it's not going to touch the ground, it's not allowed to touch the ground. But the concept is to take the mochim, the intellect, what I understand, and to pull it all the way down into my body. So if you can't do it with a physical tefillin, then you have to arouse your intellect with learning. And when you arouse your intellect with learning, you trigger like senses in your mind of intellect, then your brain becomes much more powerful. So it's able to control your emotions and your desires from the heart. And that can be achieved not with necessarily the physical tefillin. The point is to do take a time of the day that you're refreshing your mind. So you read a little bit of Tehillim. You read so many little things that one can read if you're not into learning too much. So many little things that I know people read, whether it's the Tikkun HaKlali, whether it's Kipitur Maktoret, Shir HaShirim, Perek Shira, all these little things that you trigger some senses in your mind. But more than that, is to learn what's called the mochin of the Torah, which will be the mystical part of the Torah, whether it's Hasidut or Kabbalah or Zohar. So the intellect will have the power. So when a thought comes in, you know how to push the thought away and to control it. I'm not saying it's easy, but I'm saying that's what we have to do. Because if I don't do that, then the heart starts controlling and then I'm a slave to the heart. And then I'm back to square one, I'm back in Mitzrayim. So the connection between the parasha and the Yetziat Mitzrayim is that Hashem said, I have to break Paro. And I have to break the Paro in me, the Mitzri, what puts me in my limit. I have a limit. In most cases, I have 10 or 20 limits, things that limit me. And the way to break out of my limitation, nobody wants to be limited. I don't want to be slaved to the fridge or to the box of cigarettes or to whatever it is. I don't want to be a slave to anything. I want to be free. And the way to do it is I have to break the limitation. And to break the limitation is to bring my mind to control my body, to control my heart. And the way to do that is through my physical and spiritual tefillin, is strengthening my thoughts, strengthening my mind. That's how I live my Mitzrayim every day. Mezrat Hashem, this is something you can take on yourself and we can develop it if you wish. We can do some more classes about strengthening the power of the brain and the power of the thoughts, because the thoughts are very powerful. And to a point that we know that many sages, Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, would do all the mitzvot with his thoughts. He didn't have tefillin. He didn't have lulav or sukkah. He didn't have anything. He would do all the mitzvot with his mind. His mind was so powerful, he was able to be in the state of mind of doing the mitzvah. I mean, we're not going to be Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai ever again, and don't even think that we're going to be Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. But it goes to show you that our mind is so powerful. There are no individuals that are sitting in jail, they're totally fine because their mind is somewhere else. The body is in jail, but not the mind. And the jail doesn't have to be a jail with brick walls. We are also in jail. People are in jail in their life. You said before, depression, sadness, all sorts of things that we deal with, that's a jail. But if my body is in jail, that's one thing. If my mind is in jail, that's a bad thing. So Bezrat Hashem, we should merit and will merit to go out of our Mitzrayim every day. And Bezrat Hashem, if we all do our part, our small part of fighting our Yetzer Hara and our overpowering our desires, we will merit to have our own personal redemption and our own Yetziat Mitzrayim. The point to take, the most important thing to take from that is that I have to constantly be in this motion, what's called itkafia, is to subdue my heart. And the result from that is called itapcha, transforming itapcha shochal le'neora, transforming the darkness into light. And this happens when I leave my own Mitzrayim. That's why the last plague, not the last, one of the last plagues was the choshech, was the darkness. Because we are in darkness, I have to transform it. I have to break this darkness. And I do that by subduing my inclination and my heart, the motion of it kafya and it habcha. So we're only going to left with wishing you atzlacha in your new task to take on yourself. But I can promise you, when you put your mind to it, even the term in English, put your mind to it, you'll be able to do it. You'll be able to break all your barriers and all your limitations and to go into your personal Yetziat Mitzrayim. And that should, Bezrat Hashem, happen very soon, and we should be out of this, finally, this exile, and walk into the redemption. Have a beautiful, beautiful week.